Good morning, everyone. I'm sorry, right now we're having problems with our display for the wall, so we will punt and make it work. It will be fine. Say a quick prayer. I want to welcome everyone that's watching us on Facebook Live. They're with us at this moment, or those who will be watching later on replay. We are so glad you're able to join us. My name is Joanne Hipple, and I will be your worship leader today. A quick note about why you're seeing myself up here. We did hear from Pastor Greg and Joyce Ann, and they both tested positive for COVID this past week. They thought they may have had it last week. That's why he didn't come. He wanted to make sure everyone was safe. And we got the results back, and they both are positive. We ask that you keep them in your prayers, and everyone else who is sick with COVID or somebody else, make sure you keep all those in your prayers. I did talk to them yesterday, and they're not worse than they were, but they're not better than what they were. So in between the two of them, they have all the symptoms, just not all of them in one person. So I don't know if that's good or bad, but just keep them in your prayers. Today we have the privilege of having Pastor Roger Easland here to give us our message. Pastor Easland is a retired pastor who has served at First Congregational United Church of Christ in Pierre and at Fort Pierre Congregational Church. And we're very happy to have you here today to give us the message, because I didn't want to have to write the one for this week. So, and Greg wasn't going to write it for me to read. I don't understand that at all. I was going to joke with him earlier before he got sick about this is Pastor Appreciation Month, and that maybe we should give him a Sunday off. Well, he's gotten two, possibly three. We'll see about that, but I'm pretty sure he would rather be here than have that kind of a vacation. So, that being said, we'll do our call to worship, and those who have bulletins up here with a you guys up here, you just have to talk really loud so people can hear you. So we belong to God. God's stamp is on our lives. God's love and compassion is built into us. God's mercy and hope flow through us. Let's celebrate the powerful presence of God. Let's rejoice in all the opportunities God gives us to serve. Our opening prayer is, I love you, Lord. And it's a very simple song. We'll go through it. Let's do it three times this time, just so that the first time they can get the words and everything, and then we'll go from there.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice.
Let us pray. God of power and might, Help us to recognize the imprint of your love and mercy in our lives. Open our hearts to that love, that we may grow in our faith and be strengthened in our witness to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Julia Jones is going to be doing the children's message for us, and I'm pretty sure it's the children of all ages. So if everyone just stay in their seats.
Yep, just stay where you are there.
I have a wipe for you.
Thank you.
Don't take that from me yet.
All right.
Let's go way deep and get this one. Do you want to wipe yourself?
I'll wipe myself. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Well, good morning. So, I've got something on here. Can you guys tell me what it is? It is a name tag. Obviously, yes, it says my name on it. It says Julia. So, I want to ask, why do we sometimes wear name tags? Can you think of a couple of reasons? Can you shoot out a reason for me, Will? Pardon me? Yes, you hit on it, to remember people's names. We might already know the name, but it's easy to forget it. Or, now that we're wearing masks, we might not recognize each other. That's happened to me. I've gone to the grocery store, and it's kind of like, oh, that person just said hi to me, and I'm not sure who that was. Yeah. Another reason that we might wear a name tag is because maybe we don't know each other all yet. Have you ever worn one like, well, can you tell me a couple of places where you might have worn one, Greta? Yep, school. Yeah, and we also see our teachers with their name tags on, don't we? Yeah. How about Bible school? Yep, because a lot of times the teachers we have at Bible school haven't met us before. Church camp, have you ever made a really cool one at church camp? Okay, I got to make one where we burned our names into some wood and then got to wear it. That was a really cool name tag. All righty. Well, we're going to hear a story this morning, one of our Bible stories, and in it, God and Moses are having a chat. Okay, so they're having a little conversation. And God says to Moses, he says, you know, Moses, I know you by name. And I'm thinking to myself, did Moses have a name tag on? I'm sure he didn't. I'm pretty sure he didn't anyway. And I don't think, at least it's not written in the Bible, where Moses said, hey, God, nice to meet you. My name is Moses. No, God said, hey, Moses, I know you. You can take comfort in that. I know you, and I know you by name, and I'm not going to forget it. So the point that I'd like to give us this morning is that God knows each of us by name, and we don't even have to wear a name tag. He will not forget us because he made us. He loves us, and he's always with us. And that's our point today. We are known and we are loved and cherished, no matter what we do or where we go. Let's bow our heads. Loving God, we are so grateful that you made us, that you love us, that you know us, and that you never forget us. Please help us to learn more and more about you so that we can know you better too. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. So this is still clean. Yep. All right. It's still wet and clean, my dear. I'll take the wipe.
Thank you. Thank you, Julia. I need to lift up a couple of announcements for things going on in the church. Most of those were lifted up in the video update that we do on Thursdays or Fridays. So if you get a chance, go look at those. Pictures are needed by October 23rd to honor those people who have influenced our lives that we may call saint. So a saint is someone who has influenced your life, that has helped you grow in your faith. And those persons could be alive, or they could be already in heaven watching from there and cheering you on. We also would like pictures of our veterans, those who are not currently serving in active duty, and those who have served in the past, because we'll be honoring those people on the Sunday before Veterans Day. But all pictures need to be into the office by the October 23rd. Our home-cooked meals has really helped a lot of people during COVID. We changed our parameters. It used to be that we'd ask you to come pick up a meal and give it to someone who needs hope. We decided that everybody needs hope right now. And so we just let people come get meals, and we've told PARs, and they've told people come get meals, so much so that we're down to only like 7 meals. We had over 95 meals when we started this earlier. And so, which is a great thing that we've done in this program. So that being said, we were just saying like you guys can have like 2 meals instead of just 1. And now we're backing off to 1 until those are gone. And this coming week, we'll be making more meals. We'll also be making some to sell to help raise the money for us to buy more crock pots and provide the money to bring more meals. So more information coming to that in the next couple of weeks. The November-December upper rooms are available in the tote by the front door. The office doesn't need to be open. You just walk up to the door and grab your upper room out of the container that's there. The one thing for October is a towel, a washcloth, and 2 bars of soap. You can bring all of that, or you can just bring parts of it and put the packages together. And our loose change offering, instead of taking it only one Sunday, we're taking it every Sunday, or actually any day the office is open, you can come in and give them loose change. And that money is going to the PARS holiday meals, and those deadlines are coming up. I think one of the deadlines is November 1st, and I think the other deadline is December 1st. So if you want to order a holiday meal for given away. Lifeline screening is going to be here on October 26th. You can contact the office to get their number to make an appointment. Are there any announcements that I need to make? And if you haven't heard, the Halloween Carnival has been canceled for our church. It's safer that way for everybody, so whatever you do, please be safe. And everything that you do. It is that kind of a season that we have right now. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you watch over us. Be with us during this time. It's been a really strange 3/4 of a year already, and we know that the rest of the year will be the same way. We don't see an end anytime real soon. But Lord, we ask that you are with all the medical people, the research people, our first responders, all those who are working on trying to find a cure, or at least a way for us to handle it a lot better than what it's doing right now. Lord, we want to lift up the people in our church. We ask that you hold them, give them healing, give them comfort. We ask that you also hold their families too, and all their friends. Because, Lord, those are the support systems, and they need your help, too, to give comfort, to give grace, to do all those things that we can give ourselves, but that power coming through you, and that you will also surround them. We lift up Pastor Greg and Joyce Ann, Al Yoakum, Jean Collette, Sherry Barden, Rose Malsom, Gaitha and Robert Tanak, Nancy Sterling, August Nyhart, Shelley Nielsen, Tori Ratlingleaf, Les Trout, Barb Sogard, Melissa Flottmeyer, Ashley Boone, Tim Kirkpatrick, Cindy Paul, Alan Wink, Vicki Haddam, Al Christie, Dean DeGoyer, Chad Sofus, Delora Bennett, Etta Warden, David Wilbur, Nancy and Jane Howard, Barbara Smedley, Ron Mackey, Penelope June Geigel, Nicole Chesky, Brad Maskovich, And Lord, again, everyone that has been quarantined with the COVID or even any kind of sickness, this quarantine time is very hard on a lot of people. So please watch over those people also. Lord, we ask that you watch over our world leaders also. Even our state leaders, our county and our city leaders. Please touch their hearts and let them be nice. Play nice during this time. Lord, we know that during this time of election that people say things and they do things and it affects our relationship with our neighbors. So all we ask is that you love your neighbor as you love yourself, which is God's commandment. No matter who they want to vote for, who they don't want to vote for, or what they want to vote for, or what they don't want to vote for, Lord, we ask that you show us the kindness so that we can pass that kindness on to our neighbors. And Lord, we pray all these things in your glorious Jesus' name, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have two readings this morning. The first one is going to be from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. I'm sorry, I probably got that out of order for you. Good. So, I forgot to print out this message, this part of the scripture, so thank goodness for technology. From Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Thessalonians church that is in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace all to all of you. We always thank God for all of you when we mention you constantly in our prayers. This is because we remember your work that comes from faith, your effort that comes from love, and your perseverance that comes from hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the presence of our God and Father. Brothers and sisters, you are loved by God, and we know that he has chosen you. We know this because our good news didn't come to you just in speech, but also with power and the Holy Spirit and with deep conviction. You know as well as we do what kind of people we were when we were with you, which was for your sake. You became imitators of us and of the Lord when you accepted the message that came from the Holy Spirit with joy in spite of great suffering. As a result, you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The message about the Lord rang out from you. Lost my spot. Hold on. The news about your faithfulness to God has spread so that we don't even need to mention it. People tell us about what sort of welcome we had from you and how you turned to God from idols. As a result, you are serving the living and true God, and you are waiting for his Son from heaven. His Son is Jesus, who is the one he raised from the dead, and who is the one who will rescue us from the common. For the coming wrath. Our other scripture is Exodus chapter 33, verses 12 through 23. Moses said to the Lord, Look, you've been telling me, lead these people forward, but you haven't told me whom you will send with me. Yet you assured me, I know you by name and think highly of you. Now, if you do think highly of me, show me your ways so that I may know you, and so that you may really approve of me. Remember, too, that this nation is your people. The Lord replied, I'll go myself and I'll help you. Moses replied, if you won't go yourself, don't make us leave here, because how will anyone know that we have your special approval, both I and your people, unless you go with us? Only that extinguishes us, me and your people, from every other people on the earth. The Lord said to Moses, I'll do exactly what you've asked because you have my special approval and I know you by name. Moses said, please show me your glorious presence. The Lord said, I'll make all my goodness pass in front of you and I'll proclaim before you the name, the Lord. I will be kind to whomever I wish to be kind, and I will have compassion to whomever I wish to be compassionate. But, the Lord said, you can't see my face because no one can see me and live. The Lord said, here is a place near me where you will stand beside the rock. As my glorious presence passes by, I'll set you in a gap in the rock, and I'll cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I'll take away my hand, and you will see my back, but my face won't be visible. These are the words from the Bible, from God. And we're going to say hallelujah, thank you, Lord, that they got the computer up and running again. So our next hymn is How Great Thou Art.
Great thou art, great thou art. sit down. Isn't that one of the most powerful hymns in the whole, the whole shebang? Can you hear me? Is this good if I just have that laying there? Okay, we got, you got to do that. We got her. We got to do it. We got to do it. We're going to do it. All right. Well, I do want to introduce myself a little bit more. That's my wife, Jeannie. And y'all know our daughter in this church and our daughter-in-law and son. That's Bruce and Kim Easland. Kim's been a leader in your church. And I must say, you've got a lot of strong women in this church. Say amen, women.
Amen.
Thank you. And every church has a lot of strong women. I've often said, even before I was in the ministry, that if the church, if the women church, the women of the church weren't there, there wouldn't be a church. That's right, Jeannie. Thank you. Methodist. I was raised a Methodist. I was baptized in the Asbury Methodist Church in La Crosse, Wisconsin. I was confirmed in the sixth grade, and I was a horrible student. The pastor was tough, and I didn't like him. And my grandmother was our spiritual engine, and Grandma Hilda, Hildegard Hulda Ripke. Now you know she was German, and that means that she was short and wide and stubborn. Germans, come on. Amen, thank you. Anyway, I didn't like the pastor, and he could see I was a cut-up or didn't pay attention, and he said, you know, your grandmother is expecting you to be confirmed. And what I want you to do, Roger, is I want you to read the first five books of the Bible.
Oh.
Well, let me tell you something. I told my first big lie in church. I didn't do it, but I got confirmed anyway because I didn't want to embarrass my grandma. Oh, I love my grandma. She would take me out to her farm, and I won't go there, but I love my grandma. And my mom's Helen. She grew up, and then I went. We moved to DeSmith eventually, and I went to the Methodist Church there in high school. And my mother was a very active member of that church. And you know Helen, some of you. She's in the Kellys. She's 102, sharp as a tack, and don't mess with her. Yeah. And she's doing well. So, and then I wandered off to Augustana College and married my dear wife. She was a Presbyterian. And we moved out to the ranch in Lake Preston. We were there for 14 years. And she was a Presbyterian. I was a Methodist. We went to the Lutheran church as a compromise. So I became a Lutheran. And I loved the Lutheran church because at Augustana College, I always went to chapel. And they had wonderful chapel speakers there. Pastor Pete, if anybody was an alumni in my era, was there. He was there for years. And my friends were all pretty spiritual guys, and at one point they said to me, Roger, aren't you going to go to Luther Seminary with us? They were serious. I remember what I said. Charles Hazlett, he's been a pastor out in the hills for years. He's my roommate. I said, Chuck, you got to be kidding. I don't even think I believe in Jesus. So I went my separate way. Well, there was a time come when I needed to know God's name. And I wondered if God knew my name. I was 45 years old. And one morning, after a struggle, I got, Jeannie was teaching. She was gone. Everybody was gone. I had my chores done, and I got down my knees in front of the window. Or maybe I wasn't on my knees yet. I wasn't that humble. And I said, God, help me. That's a very dangerous question. Yeah. God, help me. And I didn't hear any thundering voices or anything, but inside me, the voice of God said, well, why don't you try forgiving your father? We were at odds. Bad odds. Painful odds. That was the beginning of my ministry. And then I tore up the Bible for a year. I mean, I tore it up. Every minute I wasn't taking care of cattle, I was eating up the Bible. And the time came to think, I said, I can't stand it. I got to go to seminary. I can't stand this. I got to know a lot more. And so I went to North American Baptist Seminary in Sioux Falls. I commuted off the ranch and ranched at the same time. It was quite a chore. And that's where your pastor Greg went. That's where Pastor Greg's father went. That's where Pastor Greg's son went. And there's about half of the students there are Methodist. Maybe not quite half, probably half now. And so he already knew me when he came to Pierre because I'd done a presentation at seminary. And he said, you know, I know you, Roger. I said, I don't know you, do I? He said, I don't think so, but you know Carl because Carl was here and I've known every Methodist minister in this church. And Howard Gnager and I worked closely together. We were the two guys that started and continued the ministry at the Hughes County Jail, which is right down the street here. And then when the gambling video lottery issue came up, Howard was a crusader. I was the crusader. Howard was the organization man. Now, he called me a crusader. And we had a Methodist bishop come and train us. And we met in the United Church of Christ basement every week and prayed and studied and made a strategy. I was the one you saw, some of the older ones maybe saw me on the front page of the paper that took the petition over to the governor's office to stop video lottery, and you know the rest of that story. And I know I've known every one of the rest of your pastors since then. I make it a point to know all the pastors in town. I love all the pastors in town. And one of my best teachers was a Roman Catholic priest, Father Larry Murtaugh. You don't get any more Irish than that, Catholic. And he got inside me. Boy, he made me hurt. I did pastoral clinical education with him. And the idea is that they get in your head and they examine what you said. And at one point, he shook his head at me and he said, Roger, I got one thing to say to you. One word. Control, control, control. Who are you ministering to, Roger? Are you wanting to hear yourself? Or do you want to hear the person that's sick? What's in a name? A name, a name, a name. Well, let's get into this text. Enough introduction, too much. But I think you kind of want to trust the preacher. And you can trust your pastor, Greg. I've had a couple points of need in the last couple years since he's been here. And I've gone to all the pastors here in their office, but I went to him and I said, I need you to pray for me. You get a need, you go have Pastor Greg Kroger pray for you, and you'll find out he's a man of God. You can trust him. Okay, names. We're going to dig into this text. Okay. I'm going to make it Jeannie. Jeannie is always worrisome, and she's my helper. She makes sure of all the details of my life, and she keeps track of time, because I like to get a little... We didn't know if there was going to be a clock. Right there, Jeannie. She said, you better wear your watch. I don't know if there's going to be a clock there. She's a wonderful wife. I woke up at 3 o'clock this morning, and I had this smell of food in my bedroom. I mean, strong. It woke me up. I thought, what is going on? It's 3 o'clock in the morning. She has a roast in the crock pot that just smells glorious. You know what? She knows I'm preaching today. She knows what my favorite meal is, and you know what it is? Pot roast. So let's get some beef here today. All right, names. You heard the text. Put it up there again, please, if you can. Can you make it a little smaller? See if you can. In the meantime, I got to get going here. Moses. If you know the story of the Bible, you know Moses, don't you? Say amen.
Amen.
And you know the great names of the Bible, don't you? Like Father Abraham. How about Joseph? The coat of many colors. How about Jacob? Yeah. Names are very important in the Bible. And there are certain individuals in the Bible that make the Bible real. Because why? We have to know that God talks to human beings in human language. And if God talks to human beings in human language, we want to know what he had to say. And you come to church every day or morning or what's up, docs, every week because you want the text broken open for you so you can hear God speak to you because he knows your name. It's personal, isn't it? Highly personal. Yeah, and it's individual, isn't it? But it's also universal. So here we go. Moses. Moses already knew God's name because in the same book of Exodus in chapter 3, verse 14, Moses says, hey, by the way, I'm going back to talk to the people. Who shall I say that you are? And he gives them a very strange answer. He says, say, I am that I am. Now, maybe a better translation of that is, I am the existing one. Like that better? And then we hear the name Lord a lot. Lord a lot. And Lord is the name for God that bridges over from the Old Testament to the New. What do we call Jesus? The Lord. And then there's the people of God. We're talking about the explicit names in this text. And who are the people of God called? Israel. How did they get their name? From Jacob. Remember that? God said to Jacob, you're not going to be Jacob anymore. I'm calling you Israel. Aha. And so here we have this strange picture of a strange people who shouldn't be successful because they weren't successful. How is that possible? Because they're God's people, but they were slaves. They were enslaved by a technological culture. We still don't figure out how they made they have ideas how they made the pyramids, but how did they make those things? How did they get those big stones up there? And so, here's this ragtag people, and Moses of all people, that little baby, that was a little Hebrew baby that somebody set out to die. And that wonderful Egyptian lady said, oh, give me that baby. That was a mama. I want to raise that baby. And she raised him up, and she raised him up in that culture. That's all he knew. But he knew something was different about him because he knew he was a Hebrew baby. He was a Hebrew baby. And finally he had to go down to the ghetto and see some of his people because he wanted to know who he really was, didn't he? Don't we want to know who am I? That's why we got ancestry.com. I want to know my roots. My sister's into it huge. Oh. Actually, I've had the test, you know. My genetics goes back to where? North Africa. Serious. I like that. Anyway, Moses is an unlikely character, and actually didn't seem to be a very nice person. Because what did he do when he found the Egyptian guard beating up one of the slaves? He killed him, and he buried him in the sand because he thought he was going to get away with murder. Only later he found out some of the Hebrews had spotted him. And so he thought, uh-oh, I better hide out, because if they know it, they're going to squeal on me, and I'm cooked. So he goes and lives with some of his own people. He finds a wife, and he becomes a leader of a nation. And in due time, God says, in due time, all right, how old was Moses when he started his ministry? I think 80. He's an old man, an old man. And God says, I'm going to use you. Come on. I'm going to make it really nasty on Pharaoh. And I'm going to give you a route of escape. So get out of there. So you know the story. It wasn't just Cecil B. DeMille. You believe the story, don't you? Huh? It wasn't Charlton Heston that was on the hill. It was Moses. And so it's quite a story. Where does he lead them? The desert of sin. What? God's people? 40 years? Huh? 40 years in the desert of sin, and they wander in there, and Moses is trying to bring them, turn them into a godly community, because he's met the holy God. And so he builds a fence. What is that fence? That's the Ten Commandments. He asks God, look, they're going back. They want to go back to Egypt. They're stiff-necked people. They don't listen. They're worse than my congregation. No, I'm just kidding. And they aren't listening to me. I need help. I'm getting discouraged. I'm old. Even my helper doesn't do very good. He won't even come up here with me. He's too afraid. He stays in the tent. And the people, he got a temper, doesn't he? The first set of tablets, what happened? He came down in there worshiping the golden calf, and he busted him. He's not a real nice fellow at times. He knows he needs God to make this work. So he goes and talks to God, because he's having these conversations, simple dialogue, and he says, show me yourself. Don't we want that when things are really, when we're on really troubled waters? Hey, God, show up! We need you really desperately now. I know last week we were in good shape, but right now we found out we got cancer. We found out that we lost our baby. We found out we lost our job. I don't know how to pay the rent. We found out that grandma has COVID. What a story. So God says, okay, Moses, I know you. I know you all so well. You want to know everything just like Adam and Eve did. Yeah, you do, don't you? But come with me. I'm going to show you what I can. So there's that great hymn that you picked. Did you pick it, Ron? Rock of Ages? For today's... Did you pick it? You got hymns running through your head constantly all day long, don't you? They minister, the hymns minister to your mind, don't they? Which they do to all of us. And so he says, look, come up to the mountain with me, and I'm going to set you beside this rock. And we're going to have a little visit. I'm going to show you myself. Moses must be terrified. He should be. He already knew that God was a God of ultimate power. How did this people survive in the wilderness? I'm watching the time, honey. I'm going to get there. They survived by the pillar of cloud at night, at day, so they wouldn't fry in the sun, and they had what to keep them warm at night? Huh?
Fire.
The fire! What does that represent? That represents God, doesn't it? The fire. Moses says, like Abraham, remember the burning bush? I want to see the fire, baby. Come on. Let's go. I want to see your fire. I don't think I can do this. So God says, come with me. And he puts them in what? The cleft of the rock. It's a great big crag. If you go to Sylvan Lake, you can stand on those huge rocks. You can get down in there in the cleft. If you go out to Black Hills, there's all kinds of places to hide in the rocks. Moses figures he better do this, so he gets in there, and God says, I'm gonna pass by, but you can't see my face, because you'll fry. Because God is a consuming fire. Remember the first commandment? I'm a jealous God. Nobody messes with my people. They'll pay the price eventually. We don't get that preached too much. God is a consuming fire. So Moses goes in the rock, and of course God goes by. And how else does God protect Moses from the direct view of God? He puts his hand in front of him, doesn't he? So, okay, let's get there. Let's get there more quickly. There is the explicit names, Moses, Yahweh, I am that I am, the existing ones. There's Israel, those are explicit, and now is the implicit. And these are objects, the rock, what does that represent, and the hand. You're going to love this. It's Jesus. It's Jesus. Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Why? Because we can't stand before the totalness of God, and God knows it. So, those are the two implicit things, and the glory. I'm going to show you my glory, but you can't handle all of my glory. I'm going to give you the portion of my glory that will bring you able to bring the people out of his it to the promised land. Moses never gets to see it, does he? So here we have the rock and the hand and the glory. So here's what I want you to get. And this is new teaching probably to you. Are you listening to me? Say amen.
Amen.
I like that. God has an essence that's ineffable, unknowable, so powerful that mankind cannot endure it. Okay, it's called the wrath of God. But God also has a character. And we know the character of God. Your pastor, Greg, always prays. You said loving God. Greg always says gracious and loving God, just about every prayer, doesn't he? Why? How does he do that? Why does he do that? Because he knows God. So here's Moses hiding in the rock. And God's essential being, the same essentialness, the essence that Jesus has and the Holy Spirit has, because God's a Trinity, the Trinity's there. Jesus is represented by the rock and the hand. And the Spirit is the glory, the energies of God. And God says, you can't have my essence or you'll become God and then things will really be a mess. But you can have some of my energies. Are you hearing me? So God gives Moses some of his energy. What do we call that in modern church? Huh? The Holy Spirit, being filled with the Holy Spirit. I've been in Pentecostal churches. There was a phase when Jeannie and I went to a wild Pentecostal church that met in a motel, and people went under the power and spoke in tongues. We've been all through that stuff. Maybe you have, maybe you haven't. I've seen it. Some of it was real and some of it was fake. But what's this text about for you, church? It's for you because God is and has and is right now, as I speak, giving you some of his energy. Some of the divine energies are going to you. Ron, you look kind of stunned here. What's going on here? Gretchen is getting this, even though she looks like she's sleeping. Do you want that? You want it? Do you need it? That's what your pastor's been preaching for 2 years. Who are we now, church? Have you heard it? Where do we go from here, church? He got new leaders set up. He's a hard-working pastor. Huh? He wants you to move forward, doesn't he? Because God wants the church to move forward. Say amen. Amen. You want to be a place of energy and joy. And that was a wonderful prayer, Joanne. You were in the spirit when you prayed, weren't you? Huh? You were talking to God. Hallelujah. Oh, we're just a little ragtag band and we're on troubled waters. Oh, Jesus, what are we going to do? Oh, we'll get through it. It sucks. It hurts. We don't want our leader down. Well, God provides, even an old retired guy. Huh? Yeah. All right. That was page one. We're not going to get to all the rest of it. Okay, I'm going to get to a couple more points. Who else is implied in here in names? The name is the audience. The audience. Who's the audience? It was the audience, of course, was the people of God in the wilderness. That was Moses' audience. But now you are the audience. You are in the story. You are on the great ship traveling through the sea of the desert of sin. Oh, hallelujah. Don't you want some more people to get on board? Huh? That's evangelism. Get on board. Where did you serve, sir? Did you go across the ocean to serve? Where? Korea. You know what it's like to be on the ocean heading for Korea. Scary place. Need a big ship. Need a good captain. You need a crew. Yeah. You got it. You got everything. Everything you need. You got it. So, here we go. Names are important. And Moses knows the name of God, and he knows the character of God, because in the energies give you the knowledge of God. Compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, full of love, faithful to 1,000 generations, forgiving of all your rebellion and sins. Okay, now somebody's out there and they're watching. Maybe they just flicked in here. Maybe you're in a crisis. Maybe you're not. We want to invite you to meet Jesus. What do you got to do that? Well, you got to turn. You got to turn towards him. What do you call it? Repentance. You got to turn. Church, you got to turn. We had our first pastor's meeting about the riots in Minneapolis, because one of the pastor's daughter lived right in that neighborhood. And Greg was asked to pray, and he prayed for repentance for the church. I thought, yes. Yeah. I've been around a while. I've preached in 7 different churches in this town. And I came to Greg when he first came here, and I said, don't let him put a chain around your neck. I know what it's like to walk up the aisle with a log chain around my neck, because I think the congregation is not really for me. And I don't think they're going to listen to what I got to say. Oh. You got a lot of good people here, but you're going to have some resistance like every pastor has in every church. Yeah. You've seen it. Yeah. So, you're ready. You're ready, people. And you people watching in. I minister to a lot of people that will never walk through the door. I mean, my jail ministry is 30 years long, and I got a group of people in town, they call me preacher. And sarcastically. Oh yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Okay, everybody shut up. No more bad words. Here comes the preacher. All right. I'm just a human being too. Just a sinner saved by grace. God knows my name. Let us pray. God, today we need to get a fresh filling of that energy, that Holy Spirit, to be the church, to stop being critics, stop the common backstabbing, and to reach out to our neighbors in love. It's a simple thing. It's not rocket science. You're with us. You're here now. You're going to be here to the end of the age, because the kingdom of God is eternal, and you're eternal, and you're bigger than any political party or nation. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. We're going to get there. I'm just about had it, Jeannie. I'm going to go over 5 minutes. I always do. You're going to get an extra 5 minutes. Okay, so we are going to sing, O God of Mercy, God of Light, and have an offering. Is there going to be an offering plate in the back someplace? How's that doing? Okay. Offering prayer and give God thanks for the offering that's going to be given for those out there that are sending their offerings in and all that's happening. The church needs money, just like all. And Jesus, if you read the gospel text, doesn't condemn money. He says, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and we need money to operate. And so send your money in. Thank you if you did, and thank you for the gifts we've gotten. And so then we're going to move towards the end of the service, which is a song, I believe. Is that correct? Am I leaving anything very serious out? All right, let's stand up together and sing God, Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure. Not the labor of my hand and fulfill thy lawful grants. Could my veil no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to cross I cling. Make it come before for grace. Help us look to thee for grace. Call I to the fountain God. Wash me, Savior, or I lie.
All right, let us have a benediction. And I want you to have a great day. God bless these people, your people. Oh, it looks like a remnant that came this morning. That doesn't matter. They came. Those that are listening, listened. Those that need to hear, bring them to us so we can talk to them and love them. Give us your grace, your peace, which passes all understanding, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go. Amen.